Okay, this lesson for the Corne Project class. Yesterday we had marked a six-year anniversary since our IamCorne.org Apologetic and Outreach Ministry formally began. And on the 6th of June, I was collaborating with Dr. John Penn and receiving some more information from him and exchanging research. And I picked up this paper from, I guess, that area, Benton, and it said local students complete seminary program. And I was quite startled. I thought, where is this seminary? And so I bought the paper, and I was long after I returned home. So I was noticing it, and it's actually a high school where students graduated with seminary degrees when they also graduate high school. So the dozen students, I was quite impressed and thought, my, what a structured approach, what a disciplined and designed format that must be. And I noticed it's the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints and Benton High School. So that was quite a startle, because you have to admire their structure and discipline. I remember our pastor years ago, Dr. Lynn Baxter, would say, there are certain groups out there that have the right method and the wrong message, and we have the right message and the wrong method. And that was quite a convoluted, it seemed so contradictory, because how would we have the right message and then not also the means to take it forward? Because that would certainly be at the expense of Christ and all that he had accomplished, and certainly it would deprive God of the glory and Jesus' death if we can't even communicate it to others, and all the benefits and privileges and rights thereunto appertaining in that finished work of Christ. Then, so it was quite futile. It was quite disturbing. And he made a comment years and years and years ago that one day someone will come along and just pick up the Bible and believe it, and the rest of us will be embarrassed. Well, it was quite convicting back when I could use that word without being concerned of those who have fixity on every word you say. But I was quite convicted and literally was thinking, Lord, don't let me be the person who is embarrassed by someone else using the Bible. So I found myself very much, I suppose, as I taught the young people and still teach them, you pick your peers. That is, when children talk about peer pressure, I stop them and say, well, you select your peers. So if you want to be someone who excels in school, you'll find friends who are academic and focused on school. And if you want to find, if you want to excel in character and go forward and become, let's say, a person who realizes their potential, and you want to be a good steward of all that God has afforded you, then you'll surround yourself with people like that. So I have friends such as former professor or students from seminary and people who labor in word and doctrine, or I go and get resources. For example, this book, Discovering Acts by Dwayne Hopper, the late Dwayne Hopper. He quite a scholar and went through the book of Acts. So you won't run into people like this or find resources like this. So word people are hard to find, and people who simply prefer Bible categories, those words that are inspired, those that we would find in a lexicon and then context accordingly, that'd be difficult to find. And I suppose that leads to things that I read about in psychology of religion, attribution, reading about the different relationship models. I really like the one that spoke of active God and an active man collaborating, meaning we know we're believing, trusting, and we know God is saving. We are following, he's leading. We know that we're the ones who have been saved. We're passive. That act was passive, saving us, fathering us, recreating us in Christ Jesus. And yet it seems to be the model, if you will, in the New Testament. Paul himself said that he knew and had known and was still always knowing the one in whom he had believed and was always believing. So it seems odd that mental models, for example, constructs, let's say, statements of faith, doctrinal statements, even confessions, it seems that now the energy is still, rather than seeing that as a threshold of entry, to establish a scaffolding so that someone can, if you will, come into a faith, or someone who wants to say, well, I want a summary statement of what you all hold to be true. And then it seems to have now become, well, now let's use the text to support that. And yet we see people in groups that we would consider advocates of aberrant theology, occultic, certainly nothing we would expect to see this number of graduates at this young of an age. It speaks of how early they rose and their dedication and their discipline. It just echoed back to our pastor, Dr. Lynn Baxter's words, they have the right method but the wrong message. And I'm struck because I noticed Dr. Lynn Rayburn once spoke at a missions conference about churches that turn inward. And I understand that now, because you would think that if a church were aware of the billions of people on the planet and they being trusted the gospel to go out and make disciples, that their inward focus would not be so much a focus that also, for example, in my case, a subject matter expert with specialized knowledge seems to be called upon for many things other than what I'm trained to do. So it would help explain why even a church, for example, might not have produced 12 graduates seminary from their own church, for example, from that particular local ecclesia, simultaneously as they graduate high school, where they could say not only did they graduate high school, but they completed design curriculum. So it's odd to me that that wouldn't be the case, that every ecclesia, for example, independent, self-sufficient, whatever we want to say, especially what we know in the Bible about the ecclesia. And then construct fixity, which I've never actually was quite so acutely aware of it. I noticed as I have been in dialogue with several men, it was interesting that you'll hear people ridiculing somebody for King James only. Now, I'm not supporting King James onlyism, whatever that is, but the 1873 King James Version, which was corrected by Cambridge University, and that is, errors were removed as they should have been, and the format reflecting the intention of the original translation committee that used essentially Tyndale's translation and then amended it. So, but that had been pointed out, those numerous hundreds and hundreds of errors had been pointed out by someone who was called a Baptist, I think Tom Curtis, something like, anyway. Well, what he had noticed was, so Cambridge University was distributing one of the King James versions of the Bible littered with errors, and I guess had not been made aware of it, or had not noticed that maybe they weren't even using it themselves. So, but when someone says that, the thing that struck me is when I noticed someone ridiculing someone for being King James only, which this is a translation according to formal equivalency, word for word translation. It's a valid translation. It's the word of God. And it had undergone quite a process of scrutiny that called for Cambridge University to go back and painstakingly go through it. An F.H. Scrivener, one of their scholars, went through, and especially according to the feedback from the people in the category called Baptist, who gave their feedback and insisted that it be corrected. But it was interesting because no one talks about Calvinism onlyism, or Calvin onlyism, or Armin onlyism, or Luther onlyism, or Molin onlyism, which is quite striking because those are just fallible constructs, quite abridged and, you know, like a thumbnail. You know, here's your 5 points of Calvinism with a few catchy arguments on the back, a couple of syllogistic expressions, but this is a Bible. So I noticed that even that contradiction was something to which people were completely oblivious. They seem to have a great deal of energy for, so there's 4 Bibles, let's say. There's the King James 1873, well prepared. It's on logos.com. It's the electronic form of the King James Bible. It's very well formatted, arranged, documented, footnotes, even has notes about changes or corrections. There's even a university or academic version of it for students in graduate level work or post-secondary work. So that Bible is legitimate word for word, formal equivalency. ESV, I think that's one that's considered one of the top Bibles. The New American Standard, and then the NET Bible, NET Bible, like internet. So let's say those four Bibles. So if someone were to pick the King James, they'd be picking one of the four top academic, well-acknowledged, they met the threshold or the criteria of formal equivalency and word for word. And so there we have it. And let's say it was the 1873 King James Version, Cambridge edition, best of the best. And we know in history it was evaluated by users of the Bible, Baptists, for example, who used it as a rule of faith and practice. So you're picking among four Bibles, which is really interesting. And there's more controversy around picking one of those Bibles than picking one of the four constructs, let's say, Calvin, Arminian, Luther, or Molinism, which is quite interesting because it seems the fixity is quite, it generates catalysis, friction. It seems that people can just step in with formed categories. They can construct their own construct, if you will, into which to place their categories. And, for example, it's striking that in the conversation of theism, there's open or closed categories, but not living. And yet we have living theism from the Torah to the Apocalypse, in which we have context. So that makes open theism, just as I noticed on one website, CARM, produced and I guess maintained by Matt Slick. He has a section entitled Open Theism Verses. Well, that means those are the verses they use as proof text for open. But proof text is just one feature, for example. So to take that one feature of those texts and then to take other texts that, quote, prove closed theism is similar to the determinism argument. And yet we have words determined and desired in the Bible, and those have distinctions and differences. But it's interesting that living theism, in which you would then need to bring in all the text, especially the immediate context in which the phrase living occurs, is just not something that really has any traction. It's like, well, we all know the Bible teaches. Well, I'm not sure we all know much of anything if the words we use aren't the inspired categories and the context that are divinely arranged. We talk about the superintendent theory of inspiration. So we have intelligent inspiration, intelligently designed and formatted books. And if you pick one of the four, let's say you took your King James Bible, a word for word translated according to formal equivalency book. Okay, so you have a Bible now that's very much the Word of God, the product of inspiration that's been preserved for us, that's been evaluated and critiqued and errors removed, and things are here for us. Now, let's move on. Well, that doesn't seem to be the case. There still seems to be, now we have the constructs. Now are you 5-point, 4-point, 3-point, 2-point, 1-point Calvinist? Are you hyper-Calvinist, high Calvinist? Are you strict determinist? It seems that the construct fixity and fixation seem to now be lacking some pragmatic urgency where, you know, while our children are young enough and our education is here, we could seemingly find our children able to learn the inspired categories and notice the context in which they appear just as efficiently as they can the endless banter from fallible confessions, because even in confessions, it's acknowledged that only the Bible is infallible. But to find people studying and evaluating our traditions in light of the scriptures is very rare. For example, and I need to move on, my time's up, but something that would be quite remarkable in the, let's just say, within Christendom, would be, let's say, the James R. White of Alpha and Omega produce the results of his evaluation of Calvinism in light of the scriptures, the fallible Calvinism of which he's a supporter, and the infallible scriptures of which he's a scholar. Let him then, through evaluation, summative, formative, confirmative, meta-analysis, and full scope evaluation, let's say, professionally go through, according to his scholarship of the scriptures, textual criticism, and all the other things, Bible languages, hermeneutics, he has it all. And let's see that book. Let's see the results of that disparity between the fallible Calvinism and the infallible Bible. And then the Dr. Michael Brown, I suppose, he might be considered Arminian, I suppose. Well, let's see him evaluate, because he's supposedly an astute scholar of language, a publisher of vast books, and he had once been a Calvinist, now he's supposedly an Arminianist, probably more of a charismatic, whatever all that is. Wouldn't it be something to see the world turned upside down by those men like a James White produce his results of evaluation? Because he can't simply be just appropriating the construct Calvinism without having evaluated and noticing for himself the fallible elements of it, the four categories and even the modified categories that are so far removed from the text you couldn't find the word in a glossary or a lexicon, and you couldn't find a context in which the topic is even discussed. So, and then the new one, Chris Rosebrough, I think that's how he pronounced it, but he's this, he's a Lutheran, and he has a YouTube channel called Fighting for the Faith, and he is very good at evaluating and scrutinizing, as he says, where we are taking what people say and compare it to what the Word of God says. So what men say compared to what the Bible says. So I was curious, well, why doesn't he then evaluate Lutheranism in light of the scriptures? Compare the infallible with the fallible Lutheranism, and then produce his findings, define, document, and disclose those. And then, for example, let's take the unsurpassed, peerless William Lane Craig of Reasonable Faith, for example, and an advocate of Molinism, and evaluate that. Would it not be remarkable? So we talk about what do we do here at Koine, that is IamKoine.org, this Apologetic and Outreach Ministry. Well, it's what we do in the Lord's Church. We literally study the Bible. We're free to do that. And, for example, Dwayne Hopper was free to go through and say Discovering Acts, and included a translation of every word of the book, and to have this hard copy book produced. And it's unsurpassed in the excellence of his exposition, of his labor, of his toil. This book provides a thorough examination of the spread of the gospel and the churches of Jesus Christ during the critical first century. A conscious and honest attempt has been made to examine the language and events of this important book without the distraction of traditional views. Well, of course not. So this is an original study. This is a product, but I think we're all starting to notice that this is too slow. This is not ambitious enough. This is not pragmatic. It doesn't really get us where we want to go. In truth, that's impossible that that's true. It's actually the opposite. To be more faithful to support the Bible than to use the Bible to support constructs is always better. It's better for God's glory, and it's certainly better for our fellow man. So like I said, I could go through a list of 1,000 things and tell you about death by 1,000 constructs, because it's strange how empty these constructs are. And I'll end on that. But one very curious, when people want to talk to me about the age of the earth, and I said, okay, that's a number, right? Well, you know, we have a number, but okay, well, let's take numbers in the Bible and let's take ratios, and when we talk about age, are we talking about chronological or geological or biological? And all of a sudden there was really no content in the conversation. It was just categories as far apart, as young and old, and as empty as you could be. And that very much fit the pattern of construct-onlyism, which seems to be heading toward an end. It's coming to a logical conclusion called hyper-differentiation. People have just fatigued these constructs and worn them out. So now that people who pastor churches, labor in word and doctrine, support the Bible rather than a construct. Like I said, don't be too hard on King James advocates until you're willing to show that if you think King James only is irrational or not an appropriate academic position to take, you won't get a disagree with me. But if that's what you say and you make the error to deride or belittle them, and at the same time something much less an abridged construct, let's say a fallible soteriological construct like Calvinism or Arminianism or Lutheranism or Molinism, whatever all that might be, you might be careful, because you probably have a board protruding from your eye while you're trying to pluck a splinter from another. So if you must have a fixation, selecting one of the top four Bibles wouldn't be the worst thing. And then picking of some of the constructs to where your entire identity is fixated on it. And then when someone comes along to evaluate it, you've been touting and supporting a construct, but you've never evaluated, so you lack your own personal knowledge of its fallible elements, which means you have to admit you never evaluate and lie the scriptures. So that's an odd thing. And then if you're unwilling to place the infallible Bible, and I've got a King James Bible in my hand here, very nice, lightweight. The words are too small. I don't know who printed this one, but I don't know what happened to my Bibles. I picked them up and seem like all the words have shrunk now, and they don't seem to be as easy to read as they once were. But it appears that no one can notice the forest for all the trees, and no one can notice the, how would we say it? No one can know the conscientious laborers in word and doctrine for all the people that are just out there echoing and sound biting and jargon talking. And construct fixity seems to just be under the radar. No one notices, hey, why are you Calvin only? Or some people call themselves Calvinians, and they're trying to mix some of this and a little of that. And we can just throw it all out the door if we need to reset, start over, and go back to the lexicon, go back to the syntax, the grammar, and to the context in which those terms appear. And we all know what would happen. We wouldn't come out with the constructs we have today, because now we've used the Bible to support. And that's it in a word. There's really no reason to belabor it. It's a little disappointing for a pastor when you can see people are consuming material and progressing quite rapidly to the point where some of these 17, 18 year olds are leaving high school with a seminary education. It just happens to be in something that Christians wouldn't consider to be the gospel of Jesus Christ. And they even have a book called Another Testament of Jesus Christ. So at least they're honest about another testament of the Jesus about whom they speak, which is certainly not the Jesus of the Bible. But it's different to see how much can be done by those who want to do it, and then how little can be done by those who justify fixating on fallible things, even religious jargon, words without Bible meanings, categories without meanings, and clouds without water. But it seemed like the fixation is quite debilitating in just going out, preaching the gospel, baptizing those who believe it, then fellowship them into the gospel. They're in the Ecclesia under the headship of Jesus, and then teach them to self-examine, self-correct, present themselves at the Lord's table, eating the Lord's Supper, and teach them of the prayers, and notice the Ecclesia, the steadfast continuance in the apostles' doctrine, the common union, the fellowship, the breaking of the bread and then those prayers. But that seems, the Bible seems to be very well suited for effectiveness and efficiency. It just seems that neither are the outcome with construct fixity. So have a blessed day, and I'll be reviewing, revising, seeing how to take a more efficient approach, and as well as effective, and moving people along and reaching them while we have time. So you have a blessed day. And if you've been involved in Calvin-Onlyism or Armin-Onlyism or Luther-Onlyism or Molin-Only, whatever that is, just know it's more ridiculous than if your argument's against King James-Onlyism. So have a blessed day.